Seat. I'm just coming up on the British Isles now. ETA, 4 minutes according to the pilot. He says there'll be a few broken windows along the south coast with the sonic boom we're generating. Mach 3.2, apparently. Washington, London, door to door in 4 hours, they promised me. That's highly confidential, of course, Bobbitt. The Americans don't want anyone to know how fast their latest recce plane is. Ah!
General?
God almighty! No, no. Oh, I'm fine. This damn pilot isn't feeling a thing. Yes, yes. I confirm your orders, Captain. Get me to the war room in minimum time. Your motorbike leg is within the 4 hours. Short of killing us both, Bobbitt.
Wilco, sir. Very low pop of death.
Yes, but not zero, eh, Captain? They've got the Siggin stacked up waiting for us. All I know for now is what's on the news channels. That Gondwana great leader bozo has done it at last and invaded his neighbor and our oil field. General Hapstead running the war.
You a silly cow. For which, Batisse, I now apologize. Nevertheless, you should have stopped me. I was wrong. A rare outcome, of course. But even Her Majesty's hand-selected private secretary, permanent secretary, may occasionally cock things up.
Oh,
I should have delivered my thoughts personally instead of relying on that confounded texting phoning machine you gave me. What was it called? Damn stupid name. I something. I plot. I plant. Eggplant. And now he's cocking it up. Bloody mad Prime Minister. Bloody stupid invasion.
Appeasement cannot be condoned, cannot be condoned for all our children's sakes.
Fever. It never seems to get better. If only there were more women in power.
Parliament, debate would be more civilised.
Helena, my dear, I don't know if you've noticed, but the Shadow Chancellor, Miss Romina Harridan, is a woman. As is the Right Honourable Leader of the Opposition. They, of course, hate each other. As is Madam Speaker. As is the Secretary of State for Education.
Yes, but the baying chorus behind them is pretty solidly male, and they just love that warlike atmosphere. Never mind, Sir Tristram. I have an idea for saving both our faces. I'll ask Bernard to dinner and see if I can persuade him to attempt a rescue.
Ah, yes, your poetry-loving boyfriend, the PM's speechwriter, no less. How convenient. If only it were you in distress, my dear, instead of our people in Gondwana, I'm sure your boyfriend would want to come to the rescue. But with the election imminent, surely he'll be concentrating on his day job, writing the PM's speeches. Even more than on his vain attempt to write a single decent poem. Even with your ineffable charm, you may find him hard to persuade.
I believe I have mastered the art of persuading my boyfriend Bernard to do my bidding. I remember well that little girl fond of twisting copper round her thumb to do her bidding. Chiefs.
sign of her. Hope she gets here before I need another pills. I'll need a clear head with her. I've got time to wait. I should use it. Perhaps I can get another line of my poem. That science and mathematics are beautiful, and nothing else is. Keats denies the beauty of art, music, and poetry. Surely not a puzzle beyond me. I'm a poet. And I'll cling to that. Here she comes. Now that is beauty. That is beauty. Beauty in glorious technicolor. But truth. Hello, Helen.
Darling, planet, how lovely, how lovely to see you.
Truth, beauty, but not in her case.
It's been too long, too long, since we had come from a little head to head.
She doesn't say tete-a-tete. Until a holy or a project, she's until.
Wouldn't you like to put my head next to yours, so you could say my mother?
Of course I would. So I can't resist my madness.
Wouldn't you like me to sit my neat sweet?
The beauty pile on truth.
be wondering why I insisted on meeting you here tonight. Sorry about your choir practice.
I hope you think it's worth this little addition to the national debt. Or are you paying for this yourself?
The question is non-cupatory.
What? Non-cupatory? Oh, Jack Vance, of course! Good old Jack Vance, great master of science fiction.
Yes, Bernard, I just love science fiction. But this is government business, and rather urgent. And alas, it is not science fiction, but rather ugly science fact.
Urge away, old thing. I await your urging.
So very serious business. The PM is in trouble. If we don't fix it, soon the country will be in trouble. People will be embarrassed. Some people will die.
Of embarrassment? Sorry, go on, I'm paying attention.
I assume you've read my text.
Well, I tried to read it. But, you know, I find it hard to decipher your text language. I prefer not to have to use my thumbs for communication. Writing is supposed to be elegant.
Here are the circumstances of my little difficulty. The Prime Minister unfortunately misunderstood Sir Tristram's text briefing him. Sir Tristram is not good with texting either. You know of the incursion of Gondwanaland forces into our sovereign territory of the British Protectorate of South Gondwana?
It's all over the news.
Well, instead of issuing an oily string of platitudes, as he was told, the Prime Minister has effectively issued an ultimatum to the Gondwanaland President.
To frustrate the fallen troops, that usually does the trick. For you can reveal the iron fist inside the glove. Our levels can reveal the spies above the palace. guide.
My life, I have been.
I know too well the words you mandarins employ. Reveal the iron fist inside the glove. The iron fist inside the glove.
There were complicating circumstances. Sir Tristram knew them, but the PM, when he issued his unfortunate ultimatum, did not. Sir Tristram has authorized me to give you level Z clearance for this information. MI5 knows the Gondwanese have refined uranium from their mines. They have made several dirty bombs. One bomb, left in a suitcase and exploded in the City of London, could bring the country to its knees for half a year. Economic effect would be catastrophic. Thousands would suffer radiation poisoning. Some people would definitely die.
What can I do?
You have to pressure the bastard until he retracts his ultimatum.
I write his speeches. I know how he thinks. He can't retract after that. Not with the election next week. He'll lose face and then lose the election. I hate to say it, but even if he were told of the consequences, he'd still consider them a lesser evil than losing the election.
You must blackmail him.
I can't blackmail the Prime Minister.
If you don't, then the ruination of the British economy and the deaths of thousands of people will be your responsibility.
I've nothing to blackmail him with.
That, my dear Bernard, will not be a problem. I'm getting the names and phone numbers from my contact. I'll text you the details later tonight.
Effectively, an ultimatum to Gondwanaland. Yes, I had their ambassador at my office first thing this morning. Not at all cowed. Rather cocky, in fact.
Well, he would be. Good thing you have Z-level security clearance.
Just me at the Foreign Office these days. So far has our status fallen.
You need to know some most secret information which we seem to have kept from the PM so far. The Gondwanaland military have planted several dirty bombs in London. Strontium 90 or some such noxious radiation. Apparently they can detonate them at will. We don't want war with Gondwanaland. The PM must back down. You must help me persuade him.
Oh my God.
Yes, indeed.
Oh fuck.
Yes, fuck exceedingly. Your view?
He won't retract the ultimatum. His ratings have shot up. He's a shoo-in for victory next week at the elections, and another triumphant term as the people's leader. We could try and convince him of the bomb's threat and the possible horrible consequences, but you know about his desire for victory. It will sweep all before it.
Yes. I have a plan.
I'm very glad to hear it.
I'm afraid that, in fact, you won't be glad to hear it.
What do you want me to do?
I want you to say that the great Gondwana leader has agreed to withdraw his forces. He's only occupying the oil fields until he's accrued sufficient kudos with his population for facing down the imperialist power, then he'll withdraw. We have promised him assistance with securing places for the daughters of his third wife at Benenden School, plus a substantial sum in foreign aid.
Uncanny! Those are precisely the offers I had my people make this morning. His third and very favourite wife should be very suitably grateful to the great leader. We informed him that the PM's ultimatum was merely to boost his chances at the upcoming election.
Great minds think alike, do they not, Norman?
But the great leader has not accepted these terms.
A mere temporary difficulty, old chap. How fortunate we are.
How fortunate we are in our club ethos.
How lucky that we know each other's mind. How smoothly we together run the country.
And much of the rest of the world. How strongly our Mandarin ties bind us. And what comfort we draw from long association.
What pleasures from our mutual taste in arts.
What fun we have when we see Giselle together. Such a beautiful ballet.
What laughter when we part at the end of a long evening.
Let other countries' leaders be corrupt.
Let them lie and cheat, fit to bust.
Let their hapless populations be fleeced and cheated.
Let them know that in us they may trust.
We just need a little diplomacy.
A little diplomacy.
Set things up, we find it's one more small step for mankind. For mankind, it's one more small step. Just a little bit of love, so look so slow. don't look so smug.
Journalists with your penetrating questions. Who knows what you might uncover as you struggle to tear away all my protection and see me wriggling helplessly naked.
Yes, only doing my job.
We're live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go, news anchor.
Good morning, Britain. As we wake up to the news from Gondwana and the crisis with the hostages, I'm with the Shadow Chancellor, Miss Romina Haridan. We understand your party has agreed to support the government over the Gondwana invasion. Surely this is inconsistent with your anti-war manifesto policy.
Good morning, Jemima. When circumstances change, I am prepared to change my mind. What would you do?
Yes. Is your leader
in accord with the party in this matter?
This Gondwana invasion is a most serious matter. We intend to fully support the government in its strong stance against aggression.
Please answer the question. Is your leader in accord with the party in this matter?
Aggression must be resisted. Appeasement is not a good idea.
Yes, I'm sorry to press, but I must ask you to answer the question. Is your leader in accord with the party in this matter?
I accept your apology. It is sure that our great party is not in favour of giving in to threats from jumped-up dictators. We have a strong lead in the polls, and I'm sure that we shall win a handsome majority in the election.
Yes, thank you, Miss Haradan. That's all we have time for.
Always a pleasure, Jemima.
And we're out.
That was very good, thank you.
Oh, thank you, darling. Oh, now, let me meet your charming crew of reprobates. I might make the odd convert.
Good morning, Prime Minister.
Mina, I need 2 minutes of your time here in this anonymous place away from the press.
I've just been feeding the reptiles of the press. I throw them a few rotting meat, gobbets of rotting meat, and gossip. I love to see them gobble it up. 2 minutes is no problem, but I must get back to them. They're still hungry. And if they don't eat my gobbets, they might eat somebody else's.
Yes, I'm hoping for the support of the opposition on this Gondwana issue. Sir Tristan will brief you. We're having a meeting this afternoon in the war rooms, and I want you there. You can leave your leader to face the Chancellor on her own. She will not be in the loop at this stage.
We must put the interests of the country before party advantage, Gordon. If my beloved leader cannot see that and wishes to be an appeaser, then she deserves to be promoted to the other place.
Yes, we must see if we can persuade her to accept a peerage. The House of Lords needs someone of her talents. I know how ambitious you are, and ruthless enough to make it happen.
Transplanted to the realm of eternal thought. fingers may snap. For yes, I could spy with Gordon. For yes, I could spy with Gordon.
They are making us wait today, Jock.
Ours not a reason why, old boy.
I wonder where they're planning for us to do or die today.
My money's on Gondwana land.
Yes. Thank you for that insight, Captain.
I hope we're going to see some action. Let off the leash, the dogs of war. I'm tired of being an action virgin. My nature's red in tooth and claw.
I've no desire to see war again. When one is commander of the army, when one is the one to lose his men. And women too nowadays can help us.
We serve at all.
Level without fuss and general hoo-ha. I assume you all know the Shadow Chancellor. Romina is here, as we have and wish to maintain all party support in this matter. She has the full support of the leader of the opposition. And the Shadow Cabinet, I believe.
We all want this matter handled carefully. The possible downside in case of a cock-up would be most unpleasant.
General, please brief us.
The Gondwana forces comprise some 10 to 11,000 infantry, probably most of the President's Guard Division, 20 tanks, old Soviet types, maybe 40 pickup trucks with machine guns or AA artillery mounted, so-called technicals, and probably 10 Apache helicopters. I'd like to know where they got those from. They have penetrated unopposed some 20 miles across the border and currently hold the BP oil field and the copper mine. This intel comes from the CIA satellites, of course. We think some 200 British subjects are effectively being held captive.
I have, as you know, issued Gondwana with an order, an ultimatum to withdraw. If they do not, we should take suitable action. For the avoidance of doubt, by suitable action, I do, of course, mean military action. To attack and invade Gondwana in retaliation, recapture the oil fields, the copper mines, capture the capital, depose the great leader, and not withdraw until suitable reparations have been paid over. General, please outline your plans for us.
I have ordered one frigate to steam at all speed to Gondwana. It will be on station in 24 hours. It carries one Marine Commando platoon, that is 23 men, and one Apache helicopter. No other forces are available at such short notice. Our men will, of course, do their duty if ordered to do so, but I would counsel against any action with those particular odds. The 19th American Fleet is also 24 hours sailing from Gondwana. It comprises two aircraft carriers, with a complement of 400 fast jets, 50 Apache helicopters, 20,000 Marines, supporting vessels, etc. It would be prudent to have an understanding as to any support that might be forthcoming from that direction before issuing attack orders.
Not very likely to be forthcoming, I imagine. We all know that our current US presidential incumbent was elected on her fundamentalist biblical credentials, her denial of Darwinian evolution, her ability to shoot a moose, and her dislike of foreign adventures.
Especially those in partnership with one-time imperialist powers.
Of course, Her Majesty's government has more powerful and immediately deliverable military capability at its disposal. We have a Trident submarine somewhere in the Atlantic, and another in Faz Lane. Either could lob a nuke on the President's Guard Division within 20 minutes of receiving the order. I'm sure that would somewhat dissuade them from further aggression, any of them that remain to even think of it. But no doubt you will wish to keep that weaponry in reserve for defence of the realm against stronger forces, as is our normal practice.
Alas, General, I don't find that sally amusing. I feel that now is the time to enlighten you on certain recent developments. Yeah. We have learned from certain most secret sources that Gondwana also has a degree of nuclear capability in the form of suitcases packed with highly radioactive material extracted from the uranium mines in the south of the country. Transuranic isotopes, each with a half-life of some 10,000 years or more. Were one of these suitcases to be blown up with high explosive in the city of London, it is probable that our economy would suffer a catastrophic and permanent decline. Large parts of London would need to be evacuated. Millions of jobs would be lost. Tens of thousands would die from radiation. An unknown but probably large number would die from poverty-related causes, like hunger, in the ensuing years of economic collapse.
I see. I await your orders, Prime Minister.
Well, I see no reason why Gondwana should not be apprised of our own nuclear capabilities to defend our vital commercial interests and Her Majesty's subjects. Perhaps a small detonation off the coast, a mere 20 tons, might kill a few fish and the odd fisherman, justified in the greater cause.
However, Prime Minister, I have good news from the Foreign Office. Sir Norman Persimmon has just informed me. It seems that the great Gondwana leader is minded to accept your offer, to your ultimatum. He has agreed to withdraw his forces.
Ah, good.
You may claim a victory.
He may be minded to accept it. It expires at the stated deadline. If he does, then good and well. If not, poof to the sardines. You shall have my order in writing, General, within the hour. See that it is executed.
Did you do as I said?
Of course I did. Though,
I did find your detailed instruction in the text you sent, well, rather odd.
What do you mean, odd?
Well, I wondered why you thought you could blackmail the Prime Minister by threatening to leak the newspapers his failing to pay his dues at the golf club.
What? The information I gave you was that he was employing several foreigners as servants without paying any NHI tax or providing paid sick leave or retirement benefits, as the law demands.
Ah. So, 4NR. The number 4, the capital N, and then the capital R. That means foreigner.
Yes, of course.
Ah, now I see it. So, RTRMT. Retirement, obviously.
Obviously.
Sorry.
Oh my God, but everybody knows those abbreviations. Where have you been living?
Construction targeted like an arrow straight at me. Some joke of my brain is the size of a planet. It's true that I seem to see much further than most. When a problem's before me, I focus in on it. 10 billion synapses click out complexity. And the heat from my brain is enough to burn toast. The problem before me is not at all facile. Hell in a stratagem will never succeed. The PM is not very easy to blackmail. And expert blackmailers are ipso facto obscure. But I know of one who will serve in honor of me. But I know of one who will serve in honor of me. Here's the plan. It involves Romina Haridan. She has organized her annual fashion show for tomorrow. Her parliamentary fashion show. You must be there, undercover. You will model a dress. That will get you access.
Oh, Bernard, I've never done anything like that. Please, no.
We need to make sure she knows her supreme career opportunity is still available. If she acts, let us pray she has lost none of her ambition.
Oh. Woman's ambition is infinite. She could lose much of it and it would still be boundless.
It's okay. It's just for charity.
To see a lion roar. But winning after starting, now there's the snare. We have the nukes, they don't. God help them.
About time!
God help them, God help them.
General, see that it is executed. Poof to the sardine.
just. I was in love with Romina once, a blissful few days.
Really?
Yes, I was in love with her too, in my case, a blissful half.
I need to chat to her after the show. What time's your deadline?
I can pop it in the evening news at the last minute. I'm not jealous. Don't make me jealous.
I shan't, my darling. Just make sure you get the news out the way I told you. I'm leading my party to resist aggression, whereas my dear leader is an appeaser. See you later.
I hear Romina has funneled away through half your shadow cabinet.
Ah, we'll never know. We'll have to wait for her memoirs. What a woman.
Well, she's certainly into that Jemima Peascard, isn't she? TV personality presenter. Mind you, she's probably into it next too, I should wonder. I didn't know she liked girls at all. Still, I wish I had her influence with the TV crowd. You know it's Romina who instigated this pleasant little parliamentary event, angered, so she says, by the lack of attention given to the country's vital fashion industry.
Yes, apparently she claims that the fashion industry is a major contributor to Britain's export balance.
Yeah, true. It's certainly a major contributor to Romina's fashion wardrobe. By the by, I hear that things aren't going so well in the Shadow Cabinet and that Romina's fallen out big time with your leader.
Alas, yes, it could cost us the election. Those two ladies hate each other. The leader of the opposition thinks that Romina is far too pushy and after her job.
Which, of course,
she is.
Drink.
It could cost us the election, but you've got to admire her command.
Yes, you're quite right.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Well done, darlings. Excellent. Well done, Chelsea. Oh, I adore you. You're wonderful. Such pizzazz. Such embonpoint.
It is wonderful to see you again, Miss Harridan. I have always been a fond admirer of your work. You are gorgeous. You are inimitable.
Oh, Bobby, sweetheart. I do aim to please. The voters expect me to keep up appearances. Now, do leave us alone in a little moment, Bobby.
Of course, Miss Harridan.
Miss Bestie. Helena, isn't it? What a lovely name. I hear you have an urgent need to see me. You see the lengths I must go to keep my dealings from my colleagues hiding in a dressing room. You were marvellous, by the way. Not at all what one might expect from a mandarin. Sir Tristan's undersecretary, are you not? Civil servants of the higher levels, they're paid to be dull.
Yes, thank you. Sir Tristram is most grateful.
Oh, and I am most grateful to Sir Tristram for providing his most beautiful assistant to enhance my little fashion show.
Yes, thank you. Sir Tristram has asked me to suggest a little stratagem to you in relation to this Gondwana matter.
Of course, a little stratagem, of course.
You do not have Z-level clearance, not extended to deputy leaders of the opposition.
No, nor to my dear colleague, the leader of the opposition. We ministers in waiting are uncleared whilst we wait. I recall being removed from the PM's little war room meeting earlier.
Yes, but I can tell you the substance. The substance to the background of our military operations in Gondwana. I must ask you to keep this most secret. This is a matter of top-level national security. If it were to become public, the consequences would be disastrous.
Of course. But the Prime Minister knows he has my support in this Gondwana matter. Though why he hasn't yet sent in a gunboat or a couple of Apache helicopters. The public would love him for it. And he surely needs a boost if he's to win re-election. We can't oppose military action, even if I wanted to, which I don't. We have a lead in the polls, but it's not that large. And my dear leader is delightfully trying to be an appeaser.
The fact is, the Gondwana people have planted several dirty bombs in London.
Dirty bombs? Does that mean what I think it means? Radioactive material? Plutonium? Strontium?
Yes. Half-lives of 10,000 years or more, some of it. If the bombs were to go off, it would cripple the country. Armageddon. Ruin our economy. Kill tens of thousands by radiation poisoning and maybe hundreds of thousands by disease and starvation till we eventually recovered. Unless the UN can ship in enough food. Or maybe an airlift will be needed. Ships too slow. If there were enough of us mandarins left alive to contain civil society and supervise the distribution, we have to think about it, but I wish I didn't. We would become a third world poor country for decades.
Sending in a gunboat, not a good idea then.
The PM wants to use a nuke instead.
What? Oh, I always thought he fancied himself as Napoleon.
Right, purely a demonstration. Fry a few sardines a few miles off the coast, as he puts it.
And supposing that does not intimidate the great Gondwana leader, what then? Armageddon?
Quite. Is there anything you can do to help? The matter is most urgent. We are prepared to countenance any methods that might, shall we say, intimidate the PM and prevent Armageddon.
I think there may be a little something I could try. Sir Tristram will be retiring soon, I hear. His position as Cabinet Secretary will become briefly vacant. The Prime Minister would indeed be overwhelmingly grateful. Not beyond the bounds of possibility that he or she might stretch out his or her hand for a long reach inside the promotion procedure. It's not unheard of for a rising star to skip two levels.
Mm-hmm.
I've now got 4 admirals and 1 vice marshal in the next office, together with the defence minister and his posse.
Yes, amazing how the command chain thickens. Buggers muddle if we're not careful. I'd like to keep the Navy out of it until we're clearer.
MI5 is here. She wants to report.
We'll have MI5. The rest in a minute.
Good morning, General.
Well?
My outfit's managed to find a couple of the dirty bombs. Destructive capabilities is as reported. The search, unfortunately, was much hampered by the PM's insistence that the whole thing be kept secret to avoid panic.
Yes. Have you got comms yet?
Yes, sir. I have encrypted communications with the Royal Marine Commando Captain on the ground in South Dunbar. He's deployed from the frigate with 22 men as ordered by yourself, sir. 55 miles from Apache to land and 18 miles from ship to shore on foot. He has held opposition, overlooking the enemy base some 15 miles past on the plain below.
What can he see?
Delta 2. This is Stingray,
acknowledge
it.
Stingray, this is Delta 2. Over.
You're allowed to.
I have good sight of the main body of the enemy from the hilltop. I can see 15 tanks and all the Apaches drawn up just outside the oil field buildings. Probably 5,000 heavily armed infantry in this location. The others must be enjoying themselves in a local township.
Thank you, Captain. You can expect the SES 2 hours after dark. Maintain cover and get some rest.
Well, Coasting Ray, out!
Thank you, Captain. Colonel, give me your plan of deployment.
A 10-man SES squad will be dropped in at first dark by parachute, and they'll make their way to join the Marines on the ground. A further 20 will be dropped near the shore, together with anti-tank weapons, and they'll be ferried onwards by the frigate's Apache. The odds are impossible, General. The men will attack if ordered. I will give the command if ordered.
None of us like it, Colonel. I'm about to alert the Navy. It is entirely possible they will be ordered to launch a nuclear strike off the coast as a demonstration. Make sure your men are well clear of the coast by 1800.
Sir.
Security is being compromised. More and more people now know the situation. The press have reporters in Gondwana and they're screaming for action for us to rescue the captured British citizens. The majority of the press certainly want a war. Only the Guardian wants what it calls negotiations, and others are labelling appeasement.
Yes. General Hapstead, please invite the Navy to join us.
To the Gondwana Land President have not been taken up. 2, our false assertion that they had been taken up has failed to moderate the Prime Minister's warlike disposition. 3, my attempted pressure on the PM has failed. I apologise for the farcical nature of the failure. 4, we have released top secret information to the Deputy Leader of the Opposition in the hope that she may make use of it to influence the PM.
Bribery, lying, and blackmail having failed, we're now turning to treason.
Quite.
For the common good.
Quite.
Servants of the crown, servants of the crown.
To us a bribe is quite contemptible, all corruption.
Another little tidbit of news before the great British public.
Okay.
Should make them choke on their cornflakes before, as they decide which way to vote later in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Timing is crucial.
Mm-hmm.
It's a matter of a bomb threat. No ordinary bomb. And I'll also have an exclusive for you on a rather surprising change of Prime Minister that I fully expect to materialise.
You think your party will win, despite its line on appeasement?
Whichever party wins, I think there will be a majority in the House for urgent and decisive action. It's merely a matter of who leads that majority.
don't follow.
Stay close to me, my pet. All will be revealed. Good evening, Gordon.
Good evening.
Thank you for meeting me here. So much more comfortable for both of us and away from prying eyes.
Romina, this matter is most secret. Not a word of what we discuss must get out.
Of course. I understand completely. Most appalling situation. The country must stand together, Gordon. You and I, we are the country. If we stand together, all will be well.
Thank you. Yes, indeed. The country must stand up for itself. We can't give in to the whims of some petty dictator. The last government, your lot, ran down our armed services to such an extent that we can't act decisively with conventional weapons. The Americans are uncharacteristically non-belligerent under the leadership of that mad, born-again, moose-shooting female. They won't help. Too many oil firms in Gondwana, perhaps. Indeed, there are circles within the intelligence community that believe this may be entirely the reason to blame for the invasion. Our recourse must be a nuclear one. A mere detonation off the coast.
And what if the demo fails to achieve the required withdrawal?
I've worked out the figures very carefully. I need you to split your party after the election and join me in a pro-war coalition. No doubt my party will split too. But together we'll have a majority against appeasement. I've worked out the figures very carefully. Together we can do anything we want.
Yes, Gordon, I agree. I'll do it. It would give me great pleasure to see my leader possibly winning the election, but not gaining power. Gutsy bitch! I have a large enough following in the party. Many more hawks will follow. I'm sure it will work.
And you will, of course, be under me as Deputy PM.
I'm sure I shall enjoy being underneath you.
Thank you. This will be my 15th year, 15th election. The last 5 with you, old boy, here at the ballet.
Life's small pleasures remain.
Yes, so they do, old boy. Though, at these prices, a vintage Bollinger is hardly a small pleasure. Still, we must make full use of our free ticket advantages. And a pleasure to see our beautiful prima ballerina Assoluta again. Though one wonders why she dances this modern stuff the way she does.
Oh, it's danceable enough. It'll serve its purpose if it blots out the progress of the masses through the ballot boxes as endlessly regurgitated by those ghastly TV pundits.
Yes. Do you remember those Gilbert and Sullivan operettas we used to do at school? Oh, I recall, you were in the upper school when I made my appearances. I used to play the girls' parts. Yes, the orchestra tuning up always reminds me.
Oh, indeed I do. I recall your sweet painted cheeks. My dreams are haunted yet.
Those were the days.
Yes, indeed. The TV newswallers of those days had all been in the war, hadn't they? Majors and wing commanders, most of them. They had gravitas. Not like those panicking ninnies today, buzzing around like blue-arsed flies.
Yes. The leak of the dirty bomb danger has paralysed their brains while simultaneously galvanising their jawbones. Still, one can't blame them, I suppose. There won't be many more small pleasures like this if one of those bombs goes off and spreads that muck around the city. I envy you your retirement. I have to stay here in town. They've made up a bunk for me in the Foreign Office bunker. I'm afraid we expect the worst.
Lucky you. I shall be safely tucked up in my Cotswold cottage, free of all care when whoever heads the new government takes over tomorrow. One does pray to avert a hung parliament. My successor is Helena Bestey, as you know. The PM insisted that she be jumped up 3 ranks. She was his choice. No one else would do. But she's no experience of hung parliaments.
Yeah, to be fair, old boy, neither do most of us. Yes. The minds of the electorate is inscrutable. We shuffle the cards, they deal us a hand, and every once in a blue moon it's a royal straight flush. Ooh. Most of the rest of the world. How strongly our Mandarin ties bind us. And what pleasures we have in long association.
What
pleasures in our mutual taste in art.
What fun when we see Giselle together.
When at last we part after a long evening.
What fun when we see Giselle together. Let other countries' rulers be corrupt.
Let them lie and cheat, fit to bust.
Let our kingdom's subjects know they trust in us.
All we need is a little diplomacy.
A little diplomacy.
Thank you.
alive in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go news anchor.
Good morning, Britain. As we wake up to the election result, it is clear there will be a hung parliament and the need for a coalition. Events are moving swiftly, with the added complications of the news from Gondwana and the crisis with the British hostages, rumours of dirty bombs on London streets, and possible British armed action. The morning papers have too much news for one headline. I'm with the Prime Minister, Mr. Gordon Blackie. Good morning, sir. What are your plans for forming a government?
The British public have decided not to give my party a majority to govern. In particular, they have rejected me as party leader. I shall therefore be resigning forthwith. It will be up to my successor as party leader to appoint a coalition. I have nothing more to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Well, back to the studio.
And we're out.
Turnout and the defections gave her the advantage. She'll be the new PM in a matter of minutes. And I think I love you.
I know I love you.
Is it the aura of power that surrounds the youngest ever Chief Secretary to the Cabinet?
Perhaps. More likely the aura of Chanel number 5 that wafts from behind your dainty ears.
Bernard, stop it. People will notice us.
What's a bit of sex among civil servants? The public might appreciate our being alive. The Cabinet Secretary needs to get used to being noticed.
I have to set an example.
I must admit, old Sir Tristram was something of a Triblier, sea green incorruptible.
What?
Carlyle of Robespierre.
Oh, yes. The extraordinary thing is that the great Gondwana leader has actually withdrawn his forces. Amazing that Sir Norman's offer of places at Benenden for his daughters actually worked at last.
Probably that was what it was all about in the first place. The real stroke of luck was the great leader's unfortunate prostate problem that required him to take an extended stay at Harley Street. He'd hardly be at war with us whilst he was visiting Harley Street. His misfortune, our good fortune. Do you really think Gordon would have attacked them with the nuke?
You'll never know, thank God.
And now you have to deal with Romina. And she is even more... She is even more ambitious than Gordon was.
Yes, don't remind me. Momentarily, my ambition is satisfied by reaching the top of our particular greasy pole. One hopes the same is true of her. Have been withdrawn from the oil fields in our protected territory.
Oh.
The president of that great country is now undergoing treatment for his unfortunate complaint in Harley Street. He has our sympathy. I shall insist that he is cared for properly. The House will also be relieved to hear that several suitcases of a toxic radioactive substance have been retrieved and are on their way to one of our power stations, where they will contribute their substance to making our old people warm this winter. Order! Order! The leader of the opposition. Madam Speaker. I congratulate the Prime Minister on her appointment as leader of the new coalition government. She has succeeded in splitting two great parties with a proud history, and history will be her judge. I commiserate with Mr. Gordon Blackie on his failure to form a government and his subsequent resignation. We would gladly have assisted him in his resistance to aggression. How ironic that his appointment as president of the International Monetary Fund will involve him in providing loans to Gondwana, paid for in part with money extracted from the British taxpayer.
Thank you.
from so recently sacked. My master and mentor has hung up his hat.
Speeches.